a doctor. Where you have to go in, diagnose the case, find out all the problems that's wrong with it, get all the symptoms, find out when it started. Jesus didn't do that. Do you understand? If I get involved in all that, I'm still human. You know, I hate to admit it, I am, okay? And if I start getting into all that, I will move from faith into this sympathy thing. You'll talk me out of faith. Because I'll start thinking like a human and not thinking like God. Because what does God need to know? I mean, think about it. What did you see a policeman that sees something going on, you know, a fight between two people. What does he need to know to stop the fight? Nothing. All he has to see is there's a problem. These two people are fighting. He didn't have to know that one's right and one's wrong. He didn't have to know who's right and who's wrong. He just has to see two people fighting, and that's not good. Separate them. Stop it. Stop it. Two words. Okay. That's our inner healing. That's J.J. Lim's inner healing. Stop it. Anyway, you have to realize that I don't need to know this stuff. It's like I said over and over again, and sooner or later, you know, when we first started ministering and teaching, traveling, the things that are common knowledge in the church now were new then. You know, the things that we were saying then were brand new. But now they've filtered through the whole church and through various camps, and so it's common knowledge, it's common belief. Eventually, this, what I'm about to say, will be common knowledge and common belief, common practice. And that's this very simple thing. No matter what the problem is, the answer is going to be the same. Doesn't matter what it is. If the answer is always the same, then I really don't even need to know what the problem is. Right? And you watch. Jesus didn't even know what the problem was many times. I mean, he had to ask him sometimes. He didn't say, what is your problem? He said, what do you want me to do for you? And you notice the people didn't say, Lord, I'm blind. Because that's not an answer. Right? I think you just be very analytical for just a second. If a blind man walks up to you, do you think Jesus didn't know the man was blind? I mean, first off, he had somebody probably lead him up there. He was probably walking, maybe had a stick, maybe he's walking up, you know, are you Jesus? I mean, he's blind. He's probably pretty obvious that he was blind. Jesus asked him, what do you want me to do for you? And you would think the guy would have gone, listen, maybe you're not Jesus. You know, hello, do you see what I'm saying? Maybe he would have thought that he would have known what the problem was. But Jesus said, what do you want? What do you mean, what I want? I'm blind. What do you think I want? You know, I'm not here to ask for a blessing, you know, a financial blessing. Right? What do you think I want? He didn't say that. Jesus said, what do you want me to do? And he said, that I might receive my sight. Right? He answered it. And Jesus, what did Jesus say? Well, let me think. Let me pray about it. Let's see what the Lord wants to do. You're blind, so... okay, you must have sinned with your eyes. What were you watching? Jesus didn't do any of that. He just said, what do you want? I want to receive my sight. He said, receive your sight. And how long do you think that took? About that long, right? That was it, right? And the man had said immediately he received his eyesight. But he didn't go into details. He didn't, I doubt seriously if he sent, you know, any of that. Well, Judas might have volunteered to go so he could get an offering from the guy later. But he didn't send anybody. He didn't see anybody go check up on the blind guy and let's make sure he really got it. No, it was done. Right? Even, do you realize, even Jesus, when the 10 lepers were healed, they went. And notice, they were healed as they went. Jesus saw no change while they were in front of him. He ministered to them. They saw no change. They all left, still appearing to have leprosy. They were healed as they went. Then one came back and said, you know, look, I'm healed. And Jesus said, your faith has made you whole, right? Jesus, but you know, the amazing thing was, Jesus said, wasn't there 10 healed? He didn't say, well, I'm glad we got one out of the 10. He didn't say that. He said, weren't there 10? In other words, you're showing gratitude. Where's the other 9? What are they doing? Right? Well, that's kind of about the way we see things all the time. We get reports out of about 1 out of 10 that actually get healed, right? And then 2 years later, I'll go back in that area, and then we'll see people that were healed of this and healed of that. So, but there's not a lot of follow-up I can do. I don't get a lot of, I don't have the manpower or the time to get people's names and what's going on in a healing service. Healing service is usually the largest service we have, and people come in from all over. They have been to the training, they have been to the seminar. They just come in, get ministered to, and leave. So there's not a lot I can do with that. But the key is, the reason I don't have to spend a long time is because I don't need to. Now, if it was me, if it was something I have to know, you know, if it's like a dial that I say, okay, what's the matter with you? Okay, sickness, it's this cancer. Okay, we're going to go with cancer now. So we're going to focus on cancer. Now, also, what organ is it affecting? Well, it's affecting the liver. Okay, well, okay, now we've got to adjust cancer and liver. We've got to get the two. You see what I'm saying? It's not a life thing. It's just life. Yeah. It is just believing God. The thing is, I'm not believing God is going to heal them. That is not what I'm believing. I'm believing by His stripes they were healed. So now my job is to deliver. First off, to proclaim to them and let them know the good news that they're already healed. They don't even know it. Right? Possibly. They possibly don't know. But they're already healed. Why? Because that's when it was done. Now, right now is not when it's being done. That's when it was done. Now's when you get it. Right? But it was done back then. Or I guess back then for you, I should point out. Back then. So, let's look here at Hebrews 3. Is this helping you at all? You understand what I'm saying here? Because I want to get you to this point where you're believing, where you make a choice to believe God. Right? Chapter 3. Let's see. I want to go down to about verse. Wow, it's hard to start somewhere. I'll start verse 1. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. For this man was counted worthy of much more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who hath builded the house has more honor than the house. For every house is builded by some man, but he that built all things is God. And Moses verily, now notice, was faithful in all his house as a servant, for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken after. But Christ as a son over his own house. Notice the difference? Moses was faithful as a servant. Jesus was faithful as a son. If you follow Moses, the best you can ever be is a servant. If you follow the law of Moses, the best you can ever be is a servant. But if you come into Christ, you are a son and not a servant. You're a son who serves, but that's a different class of being than being a servant. Okay? A servant has no rights. A son has all rights. Okay? Now, but Christ as a son over his own house, whose house are we, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope, firm unto the end. Hear that? Firm, hold on the confidence unto the end. Firm unto the end. Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost says, he's quoting out of Psalm 95. Yeah. Today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts, as in the provocation, in the day of temptation, in the wilderness. Now we're saying, don't be like they were. Don't harden your hearts. When your fathers, verse 9, when your fathers tempted me and proved me and saw my works for 40 years. Wherefore I was grieved with that generation and said, they do always err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. You hear that? And notice, you're going to see this all the way through. He always puts the rest with believing. And if you don't believe, if you harden your hearts, you don't believe, guess what? You don't enter the rest. Right? So believing and resting become synonymous. And work out of your own self, you're working, laboring, okay? And not resting, okay? And unbelieving will come together. Watch. He says, verse 12, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. Now notice again, he should talk about unbelief and not entering into a rest. Okay? But exhort one another daily while it's called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Now notice that. If you participate in sin, then you will be deceived.